got your Bibles with you, I invite you to go again to them, to go to the Gospel of John, as John also gives another understanding of Jesus' coming. Okay? Matthew and Luke especially get into the details of what we think of as a Christmas story. John puts it in that more cosmic, big picture of understanding who Jesus is and that he was coming and the realities of Emmanuel, God in human flesh. But understand that John is also reminding us that with our triune God, the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is that in effect, Jesus has been part of that community, if you will, since the very beginning, okay? And then it's part of God's plan of, behold, I make all things new. I don't want to be separated from my human creation forever. Is that God came in the person of Jesus of Nazareth that became Jesus Christ. John says this, he, meaning Jesus, he, God in human flesh, he was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own, and that would be us many times, his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. That points us to what happens in baptism when the Holy Spirit begins to form us and transform us into children of God. Okay? And is it the Word became flesh and lived for a while among us, and we've seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and full of truth. This is God's Word about understanding that other dimension of Jesus, that Emmanuel, God in human form, the incarnation, all of those things is John's version, and it is the Word of God. Amen? We're going to talk about this guy. We're going to talk about St. Nicholas, because St. Nicholas, Santa Claus, okay, originally known as St. Nicholas, many people have him. We have him as part of our Christmas celebrations, right? He has become ubiquitous, right? He's like huge in Christmas cards and advertising and everything else. So how did we get here? And I want to spend a little time talking about that and moving in that direction of really, truly redeeming Santa Claus, okay? St. Nicholas, that's where we start, okay? We start with Nicholas, who was born over in Turkey, right? Over in this area, if you like maps, and I do. And so to kind of place this and locate it, down here at the bottom of your screen is Israel, Lebanon, Syria, Iraq, Cyprus. Here's Turkey, Bulgaria, Greece is over here. In the third century, 300, right here where this arrow is pointing, in what is now modern-day Turkey, Nicholas was born to some pretty wealthy parents, but parents who were very, very faithful, very devout Christians, okay? And they raised him as a Christian 300-some years. He was actually, they say, born in 280, okay, after Jesus' resurrection, okay, 280 years. His parents died of an epidemic, okay? He died, and so he gave his life to God. He gave his life to the church and as a young man, and he became a monk, okay? He became a monk in the Eastern Orthodox, or I think I'll just say Catholic Church, and he believed, he really believed strongly that Jesus said that he should give his money to the poor, okay? And again, he lived as a monk, and so the story is and you can get this online, you can get it through the Catholic Church, through the St. Nicholas Center. I mean, St. Nicholas is a big deal worldwide, and I'm just giving you the shorthand version of his history. But he dedicated his life to serving God, and he was very generous. He was very generous, and so pretty soon he became a bishop, and he was Bishop Nicholas over there in that area of the world that we think of as Turkey, okay? And same thing, Bishop Nicholas, and you can see this icon from the Eastern Orthodox Church. You can see a young man, Nicholas, and of course, when you look at an Eastern Orthodox or Catholic icon, everything has meaning. And so these three bags of gold in his hand have meaning. It's because part of the story of Bishop Nicholas is that he knew of a man in the village who was very poor, good Christian people, and this family, this man had three daughters. And in that day, the daughters, if they could marry and marry well, like a rising tide, And so the chances of this poor man's daughter being able to marry, though, were slim, because in those days there was a dowry, okay? So the story goes that Nicholas, and this is from a tapestry, an altarpiece, if you will, painted altarpiece that would have been up at the back of a church over in Italy. This was in 1425. Okay, so this has been around a long time. The story goes that Bishop Nicholas threw the bags of money through a window so that this father would have a dowry for his daughters to be married, okay? And he was generous. He was giving. What happened, what was added to the story, which may or not be true, but back, way back then, and later on, they added to the story of Bishop Nicholas that the window was closed, shuttered, and locked, so Bishop Nicholas needed to get the money to this poor man and his family, so he dropped the bags of gold down the chimney, and it landed close to their socks that were drying by the fireplace. Does this sound familiar? It's part of the story. Okay, so of course Bishop Nicholas dies, and in 1100 years after Jesus' resurrection, Bishop Nicholas is considered a saint, capital S saint, by the church, okay? And a couple hundred years later, he was officially canonized, okay? And became St. Nicholas. And during that time, like in the 1200s, one of the next things that kind of happened is that, Bishop Nicholas's generosity and examples of that spread. And so in the 1200s, over in France, because Nicholas was considered a saint, is that nuns, Christmas season during December, they would make little gifts, and they'd wrap up the gifts in paper and string and sign a note, and they would leave them for children, poor children, anonymously, and they'd say, this is a gift from St. Nicholas, and so the legend grew, okay? St. Nicholas then became, again, officially a saint, and he became known as the protector of children and sailors, and some of you grew up Catholic. Let me see a show of hands, and this is an okay thing, you know. Good. You have a background in some of this. You grew up Catholic. So in that faith tradition, Nicholas is known as the protector of children and of sailors, the protector. But Nicholas also is the patron saint, and I confess, I don't know how this works, who assigns this, but Nicholas, Saint Nicholas, is considered the patron saint of sailors, merchants, archers, you know, like the guy in Marvel Comics, Hawkeye. Okay, so archers, I don't know, archer, we don't have a lot of those anymore. Repentant thieves, children, brewers, which a lot of people in Dubuque are happy to hear. We've got a number of those. Pawnbrokers, and unmarried people. Not being serious, that's considered the patron saint. The Catholic Church, to honor Nicholas on the day that he died on December 6th. So December 6th is the Feast of St. Nicholas. Some of you know about this, right? And some of you have this tradition. This is new to me, that some people give little gifts on December 6th for St. Nicholas Day. Does some of you know about this tradition? Okay. This is him. I mean, this is from him, this real guy, okay? This real man, okay? Bishop who became St. Nicholas over in Turkey, who embodied, who lived, who did generosity, gave generously, right? So let's keep going, though. Because, you know, we eventually get to this guy, right? And his skinny brother over there in the praise man shirt, right? Okay. So let's keep going. How do we get here? Well, the Dutch folks, you know, honored Sinterklaas. They honored the Dutch version of Santa Claus. St. Nicholas became Sinterklaas. Sinter comes close to Santa Claus. You look at these around the world, so this isn't just a European or North American thing. So, for example, it's fun to research all this stuff. You've got Sinterklaas that arrives, and he's got certain symbols, and he's got a lace shirt, I guess, instead of red velvet. You have Missy with the Scandinavian folks, kind of like those folks up in Mount Horeb with all their dwarfs and all that. Okay, so they've got Missy. It's like their version. The English have Father Christmas. Okay, now he's going for the green robe and a basket on his back. In Nigeria, who were once upon a time colonized by the British, they also talk about Father Christmas. The French have you know, the guy down there with the donkey. And the Chinese, even the Chinese have, you can see in the center, they have, what do they call it? Nice old father. That's how it translates in Chinese. Isn't it interesting, though, some of the characteristics all of these figures have in these cultures all over the world is kind of the whole white beard thing and giving. Giving. Okay? Now, obviously, in America, we have Santa Claus. And obviously, also, in the United States of America, we not only borrow from when once upon a time we were a melting pot and not a salad bowl. That's a different argument for a different day, right? But Americans borrowed things from other cultures, like Santa Claus became Santa Claus, right? And we also invented things, okay? And I'm not throwing any of this under the bus. I'm explaining again, well, how did we get here? Okay, so we invented things. We invented things about Christmas and Santa Claus. It is 1809. And I know some of you don't like dates. I'm sorry. I love dates. I love history. But here we go. Okay, 1809, Washington Irving. He also, I talked about him last week. But he wrote a book called The History of New York, including he did another book called Old Christmas. And he's the first to really refer to St. Nicholas as the patron saint of New York. And I remember back in those days, New Amsterdam is what New York was originally called, and it was very Dutch, right? Very Dutch. A lot of Dutch people there. Okay. So you're starting to get this idea of New York, a big population center, kind of this image of a guy, you know, red. He's got kind of a cool little beard. I guess that's when Santa was a young man. He's got kind of a jaunty hat on there instead of the other one. Okay. So then you fast forward to 1822, and there was an Episcopal minister. Pastor in the Episcopal Church, and he had three daughters. And he wrote a poem. He wrote a long poem for his daughters as he invented and he imagined. And so he wrote this poem called A Visit from St. Nicholas. And of course, the opening line of the poem is what? Come on, everybody, participate. We're just going to quicker. 'Twas the night before Christmas, all through the house. Okay, that's Clement Clark Moore's poem, as you can see on the screen. By 1848, it was a book, but understand the impact of this on our culture is that this poem, which became a book, gave us this modern image and the things that probably most all of us in this room and all of you online have grown up with. And I am not demonizing it, okay? I'm saying here's what it is we were given this image of Santa Claus in his little sled. And he had how many flying reindeer? Eight. He had eight. That's what we always had. And then somebody came along and said, no, we need a ninth one named Rudolph. That's red nosed guys to sleep, right? Okay. So here, you know, like at 8 o'clock, these people nailed it. You ready for the quiz? Okay, because I don't know it. And he whistled and shouted and called some by name. Now, Dasher, now, on Comet. Give yourselves a hand. It's just amazing. It's just amazing. Okay, you got them all. Go. No. Stay. We have something to do. Okay, this is part of it, though. And it's okay, right? It's okay because he gave us this idea of this right jolly old elf, kind of this heavyset guy. But he has supernatural abilities, okay? So for Clement Moore, Santa could shoot up a chimney just by nodding his head, put his finger on his nose, something like that, right? And so that was our next evolution, if you will, of this now familiar image of Santa Claus, who flies from house to house with his reindeer, and he gives presents to deserving children. Okay, there's the next step. Is that in 1881, there was a cartoonist in New York, all things come out of there, it seems, and he looked at Clement Moore's poem and the night before Christmas, A Visit from St. Nicholas, and he drew this figure. And it really created an icon here in North America of a much more rotund Santa, but looks very friendly, looks like a nice fellow, right? And he's smoking a pipe, and he's got the red outfit now, and he's got the pack on his back for kids, and he's got toys. This icon really grabbed hold of people in the turn of the century, going into the 1900s. Nast, Thomas Nast was his name, he also added on to this, right? And he not only gave give us this picture and this image of what we think of as Santa Claus, what we still have around us with Santa Claus, right? But added to it he lives where? Where does he live? North Pole. And he has a workshop, and who works for him? And he's married to who? Mrs. Claus. Very good. 8 o'clock was stopped. Like, Eleanor? No, Mrs. Claus. Just Mrs. Claus. Yeah, that's how we got here, folks. Okay, now pivot. Okay? Because here's the thing. For some families, the arrival of Santa Claus on Christmas Eve or, you know, Christmas morning, that, for some families, is the high point of this season. Now, as people who follow Jesus or proclaim to follow Jesus, we need to think about that a little bit. Okay? For some people, and certainly for a secular consumer culture, that's the high point of everything we're doing. It's all about that. Okay? And so we have put Santa Claus everywhere in all of our Christmas traditions. And for many people, it's all about the getting. And I wish you remember that and hold on to that. For many people, you see, what Santa has become is all about the getting. And so when we see one another on Christmas Day, family, friends, relatives, or the days after Christmas, what do we say? What do we ask each other? What'd you get? What did Santa give you? Okay? What did Santa leave for you? Okay? All right, that can be fun. But I was thinking about it this week, just in that really simple thing, is that Santa has become all about the getting. Okay? All about the getting. And so I looked at that and said, well, how do we redeem that? In this strong consumer culture that we live in, and make no doubts that we do, I just mentioned it, a very strong secular consumer culture, but let's not fool ourselves, because the consumer culture, consume, absolutely positively has invaded the church. My goodness, the churches, not just about here, but churches are full of people that seem to have the attitude of, what have you done for me lately? Amen. That's consumer culture. Churches are full of people that, to go way back in Grand View's history, since I've been here, are full of people that think the church is a cruise ship. And preacher, pastor, what have you done for me? What are you going to do for me? Okay, I'm a consumer. I'm going to drop my kids off, and you need to give them their Christian education, and I'll come do this, and I'll pick them up, and we'll have to spend an hour in church. I'm sorry, but I believe that's a consumer culture thing. Okay? And so I look at this and say, it's even invaded the church. Because the solid ground I stand on, as an aside, is that we believe here at Grandview that all are called to love God, love others, and serve the world, serve other people. That's part of our discipleship. That's part of being like Jesus, not just consuming, right? Jesus never taught and said, some of you should be receivers, and a small number, like 20% of you, should do all the giving. That's not in my Bible. Is it in yours? No? Yeah, no. Okay. So I go back on point. In our strong consumer culture, how in the world could we ever redeem this mythical, small g, godlike figure that we call Santa? Okay? Now, let me be clear. Some people say Santa's a myth and should be just banished from the celebration. Some people are offended that they would walk into this holy place and be on this holy ground and see these secular images of Santa and say that he needs to be gone. They say, you know, Santa, that's awfully close to the word Satan. Right? Like, some people turn into the church lady. Are you with me on that? You remember her? Satan. Okay. But here's what I say, and I want you to make sure you're hearing me, and I want to be crystal clear on this. Here's what I say. Let's redeem him. Meaning, let's get him back. Okay? Let's go back to St. Nicholas. I say, let's redeem Santa and what he has become, and let's keep him around. Let's keep him around as a way to remind us, as a way to point us towards ways that God desires us to live. Going back to what I said last week, this is what Christians have done. We've looked at something in popular culture, the Christians going way back to when we said Christmas on December 25th, and said we're going to grab hold of that, and we're going to pull it back from the secular, non-Christian culture, and we're going to use it. We're going to take it back, we're going to redeem it, and we're going to use it to do what? To point us towards God. The ways God wants us to live. I went through the whole origin of St. Nicholas, right? And I'm going to go back to this. St. Nicholas is a symbol of gift-giving. St. Nicholas is the symbol of generosity, right? And so here's what I'm saying to all of you. This means that Santa, St. Nicholas, we'll just go with Santa, he can be alive, and he can be well, and he can be real. say that Santa could be alive and could be real, the spirit of St. Nicholas in us, in our generous giving, not just being all about the getting. It made me think about, as I was going down this direction this week, it made me think about, here's another day, 1897. There was a newspaper called the New York Sun, and an 8-year-old girl wrote a letter to the editor. Maybe your parents did, but it showed up at the New York Sun, and here's an imprint, historical, from the museum in Washington, D.C. Virginia O'Hanlon wrote in, "Is there a Santa Claus?" Does some of you know what the answer was from the newspaper? Yes, Virginia, there is a Santa Claus. This is what the reporter, Francis Farsilius Church. Farsilius, that's not a name people name their babies anymore. I don't know why not. Francis Farsilius Church wrote, quote, "Yes, Virginia, there is a Santa Claus. He exists as certainly as love and generosity and devotion exist. And you know that they abound. And that these generosity and devotion and love, they abound and give to your life its highest beauty and joy. So alas, how dreary would the world be if there were no Santa Claus? Yes, there is a Santa Claus. And I've given that to all of us. St. Nicholas, this very real Christian man that set that example. And so here's one of the things I want you to think about going forward, because there's always a challenge to this, right? This isn't just a lecture of information. What if instead of thinking about and even talking to our children about and our grandchildren about anybody, what if instead of doing that, thinking about and talking about what you're going to get for Christmas, what if we begin to focus in our own minds and we begin to teach and talk to our children and the people that we influence about what they should give? What if we begin to turn that and we stop making it all about what are you going to get, and start, as Jesus' people, talking more, thinking more, praying more, communicating more with the focus on giving. What are you going to give this year, kids? What are we going to give as a household, right? What if all of us, really, for ourselves, for our households, for other people, what if we really took seriously what Jesus said as reported in Acts 20? It is more blessed to give than to receive. And many of you sitting here today, you already know that. You know how wonderful and awesome it feels to give things away, to be generous to other people, to be generous even to people that you may not know that well, or you may not even like, or you may not even know the results that you're giving. Some of you know this. You know how wonderful that feels to give, okay, beyond yourself. What if we really, as a church and as a people, made an intentional effort to be more conscious of teaching our children that, and our grandchildren, and the kids in our Sunday schools, and the kids in our church? What if we twisted that? Because you see, I believe when we take that back, that's how we redeem St. Nicholas. When we understand him, St. Nicholas, to be a model for giving, not forgetting. A model for giving. And that means that all of us, I'll say it again, can be like real life St. Nicholas's. And I do not mean the Santa with the small g God. I don't mean that we are going to become all seeing, all knowing, present everywhere. I'm talking about the spirit of St. Nicholas shown up in our acts, our very real acts of giving, our really acts of giving generously. And I'll say it again, not just one day a year on Christmas Day or leading up to Christmas Day with beautifully wrapped presents and bows and all that. What if we did this and it became a lifestyle? What if we had a St. Nicholas lifestyle all year round is what I'm advocating for? Because see, Santa should point us to living lives like that. I believe Santa, and we redeem him, okay? And it's okay to say and hope and to pray that Santa Claus is coming to town. Man, I hope Santa Claus is coming to town. And I don't mean I'm praying or hoping that Santa Claus is coming to town, coming to Grandview, because I'm going to get a bunch of stuff. My prayer is that Santa Claus is coming to town because we're going to start seeing a growth in people being generous and being giving, right? And giving more than they take is what my prayer is. And the last thing I'll say about this is you may say, well, how do we get there? How do we get to that St. Nicholas spirit of giving? How do we get there? Well, it's, to me, the equation is simple. Is it the driver, the engine of generosity, the driver of generous giving is gratitude. It's being grateful. It's being grateful not just for the people not just for the people that you do life with, but I say take it the next step in gratitude, being thankful, being grateful for what God has done for you, bringing you into the world, creating you, letting you be born at the time and the place to the people God deemed you to be born to, gifting you with the experiences, the abilities, the talents, the opportunities that molded and formed your life, okay? When we sing the doxology, praise God from whom all blessings flows, that's what it's pointing to, okay? And as much as we Americans love to think that we pulled ourselves up from our bootstraps, as Jesus' people, we try to give that credit to God, amen? And so that's what moves it. Gratitude. Gratitude for healing. Gratitude for strength. Gratitude that God gave Jesus the greatest gift in the world. Gratitude should drive our giving, our response of giving generously all year round. Gratitude that Jesus came so that we didn't have to be separated from God, living in chaos and darkness and uncertainty, right? That Jesus came so that we could find forgiveness and we could be brought into communion with God and with God's people. That gratitude, may that gratitude drive us, move us to be Santa Claus. Let me pray about that. Lord God, you know all of us as we are and who we are. And so, Lord, I pray that as we sit here as your forgiven people, I pray that you help us. Help us to acknowledge you in all the ways that you've loved us, that you've cared for us, forgiven us, all the possibilities you put in front of us. I pray, Lord God, that you have spoken. That you have spoken to us individually the word that we most needed to hear today. And Lord, for some it may be a challenging word, a word they didn't want to hear, but Lord God, I pray that you produce fruit from that word. I pray, Lord God, thank you. I pray this on behalf of all of us. And all of us pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray out loud, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those